Our second conversation is particularly interesting because here's the thing about Gurgaon. When you're talking of it as having the highest per capita income in the country, it's NCR. When you can't get one straight road, it's Haryana. Right? Our next speaker today is firmly of Haryana, for Haryana, and since he was born and grew up here, by Haryana. And I think it is a great place to start a conversation with him about where, of course, Haryana in the country's politics, but also what there is for us at home in the future. To host this conversation, it is my privilege to invite somebody new to this stage here. She has been at Algebra in Bangalore and in Hyderabad, but this is the first time she's taking the stage in Gurgaon. If you've, you know, if you've heard radio in the mornings, for 7 years she was on Good Morning Delhi. She has been on radio in Bombay. She did a stint in the UK on radio and is back most recently. Now based out of Bombay, a journalist, a writer, a public voice that you hear but don't always see, it's a pleasure to have on stage Chris Fernandez. Chris, over to you.
Good evening, Gurgaon. So who happened to have heard Radio 1 and Good Morning Delhi? Come on. Okay, so I'm Chris Fernandez, and of course I've been a radio head for most of my career. But now I have the privilege of being on this stage and here at Algebra, and a chance to be able to get up close and personal and give you a chance to get to know some really amazing voices, personalities. The guest that I have this evening for you is was a three-time member of the Lok Sabha. Comes from a political family, but it seemed from every indication of his young years that after having done engineering and his MBA and a corporate life, that was he going to go that way or was he going to be doing exactly what his grandpa and his father did? I guess we know now. From the Congress Party, I welcome to the stage Dipinder Singh Hooda. Do tell us, what is happening with your party, particularly in Maharashtra?
In the state that we are having this program, Haryana, our party is on its way to revival. You must have seen, you must have followed the state polls.
If you can bring your microphone, please.
I'm particularly happy to answer this question that we are, you know, since this program is getting hosted in Haryana. So you must have seen the state polls. We fought very well. Mm-hmm. We gave BJP a bloody nose. They were able to form the government, but how they formed the government is for the people of Haryana to judge. It was a matter of just 4,200 votes that decided who was the single largest party between the Congress and the BJP in Haryana. We ended up winning 31 seats and BJP was at 40 seats. And 5 seats that we lost out to BJP, total vote required to switch those 5 seats over to us, just 4,200 votes. So that was an election which was as narrow as that. So yes, our party is very much relevant, still it's kicking. And we hope that it's on its way to revival, and we hope that it is on its way to presenting before the people a positive alternative that the people of India need, a positive opposition that people of India need, a healthy democracy needs. So that's what we hope for, and that's what I'm sure we are going to achieve.
These must be strange times, and it has been since 2014.
By the way, thank you for that, you know, off the cuff first question, just which threw me.
Make you uncomfortable from the very start, so you can know what comes up. But since 2014, it's been challenging times, to put it mildly. What is that reboot that your party is putting itself through, that soul searching? You're talking about green shoots. But what are those things that y'all are doing that are making sure that y'all are on a decisive path to reconstructing this party? Because at this point in time, the central leadership, we don't know what it is. And there have been certain indications of, you know, the press saying that there's not enough campaigning on the ground. The NCP and particularly 1 month before the Haryana elections is when things really got kick-started. So do tell us what's going on, because I'm, you know, I think I speak to it for everyone when I say I really don't know what's going on with the Congress Party.
See, I'm a member of the Congress Working Committee. So I have a little bit of insight as far as, you know, some of the question that you want to get into. But, you know, and that people of India really want to ask of us. People of India have high expectations of the Congress Party. There is no doubt about that. And the reason is very simple, that it is my belief that the moderate, I don't want to use the word secular, but the moderate, liberal, and indeed secular vision and the modern vision that the Congress Party can provide to the people of India, that's a vision that our democracy needs also. Our democracy cannot be allowed to be seen in a monolithic, just be getting dominated by a particular vision. It needs an alternative so that people in India can choose the right path for our country, for our next generation, where we want to take the next generation. And that's the ideology that Congress Party stands for. And that is why it's our responsibility to prepare ourselves and present that alternative to the people. And you're right, this question, and I can sense in your voice, and immediately, you know, as soon as we started off this conversation, you are very eager to get an answer from me. That sense of restlessness is much more in people like me, who have devoted and dedicated our younger years towards this party, and amongst the younger generation. There are no easy answers, but there are a lot of things that we need to get right. There are a lot of internal party organizational matters also that we need to get right. But at the same time, I can assure yourself, and I thank you for the concern, because that it's a good sign for me that you are concerned about the health of opposition, because all of us should be concerned about the health of opposition and about the political health of our party. But I can assure yourself that a lot of things are going taking place inside the Congress Party right now, that perhaps it's not the appropriate forum for me to start openly discussing those things, that make me believe that our party is going to head in the right direction in the coming future. And over the next few years, you will see Congress Party taking back its space in the center stage of national politics.
When you got into politics in 2005, you were all of 27 years of age. You were sort of like the Doogie Howser of politics, if anyone has watched the show. But 27 and a parliamentarian, that had to have such a massive effect on you. What were your thoughts? Because you campaigned and you won by a decent margin. And the subsequent election, you're a three-time MP, the subsequent and even bigger margin. What were you doing at 27? Because most of us were watching movies and generally checking out the next album of music. What was going on with you?
So, as you know, Chris, so I it's a fact that I belong to a political family. So the background was in politics, and I was exposed to the space of public life and political sphere from the very beginning, since I was a young child. But consciously, it was not my decision ever to jump into politics straight away. I did my engineering, and after that, a couple of years, I worked with Infosys. And then I had gone to went abroad, I did my MBA from US, and I was working there in the corporate. I had the corporate life like any other working professional would, and I was very happy and satisfied with what I was doing there. But there were certain events that took place while I was working, which made me, which forced a decision that whether I wanted to continue there or come back. And that was the time, the mid-20s, that I decided to quit my job. I was working with McKinsey as a consultant in Dallas. And something wasn't clicking. Subconsciously, consciously I was very happy, the life was good, etc. But subconsciously, it was always the sense of incompleteness, sense that perhaps a lot more can be achieved back home. And after spending a lot of months being terrible on the horns of dilemma, you know, what would be satisfying in long term for me, I decided to return back to India and to embark upon this, took upon this political career. I've been very blessed that I had the opportunity to serve the people of my constituency. I came with a honest and straight mission to transform my own constituency, Rohtak, which is right next to Gurgaon. And I worked tirelessly towards that aim. And I was, I'm very blessed that people of my constituency blessed me three times consecutively, including 2014, when entire North India, Rohtak was the only seat that the Congress could manage to win. And even this time, although I lost my Lok Sabha elections, I was able to secure more than 6 lakh votes, which is the highest votes that any opposition candidate could win from entire 300 seats, the Hindi-speaking 300 seats in North India. So people of my constituency supported me. I worked towards the goal that I had set out for myself. And that's the journey. If that's your question, so that's the journey. And now, for me, the next chapter of that journey has started with the recently concluded Haryana elections.
I want to linger just a little bit on the fact that, you know, you won in Rohtak three times. And 2014, when there was a Modi wave, the Modi juggernaut, and just about everybody was getting swept away with that. But you weren't in 2014. 2019 is an altogether different story. What was the soul searching that you did, and what did you find out? I know you lost by a slim margin, but what was that thing that you found out was the thing that went amiss in 2019? Because the concerns have changed today. People are worried about bread and butter issues. They're worried about education and housing and air quality. And here we are talking about the same old things.
By the way, so is it really? You think people are concerned about the air quality and environment? No, the reason why I asked that question, with all due respect, is that if that was so, that would be an important electoral issue. I mean, the reason I was just listening to your last speaker, and she had made the point that till the time people speak about an issue, environment, for example, the bureaucrats and the politicians are not going to listen or pay attention. Look at what's happening in the air, as far as air pollution in Delhi. You know, I have seen 15 years, I was a member of parliament representing a constituency in National Capital Region. These 15 years, I've seen the air quality getting worse and worse. I kept on raising this issue in parliament and all the other forum, including I introduced a bill called Right to Clean Air Bill in the parliament, which suggested a instrument, a policy instrument, a simple policy instrument to solve this problem. But nobody paid any attention, including, you know, my own party or the other party or any party or any politician or any chief minister. Every time I used to see, whenever there is a, for example, I'll just take 1 minute on this issue because, you know, her talk inspires me to make a comment on this, and then we'll return back to politics. Every year, the quality of air that we breathe is going down. National Capital Region is the worst air polluted region in the entire on the entire globe, in the world. Michael Greenstone, University of Chicago, he was here recently. He gave a talk. I invited him to give talk in Maharishi Dayanand University, Rohtak. He has done groundbreaking study on this, which suggests that any child who takes birth in NCR now and sort of lives here for rest of their lives, depending on the city in NCR that you're living, Gurgaon or Rohtak or Delhi or Ghaziabad, the child would be losing on average anywhere from 6 to 8.3 years of their life. Average life expectancy will be lower by 6 to 8.3 years just because they're having the misfortune of having taken birth here and inhaling the kind of air pollution here. But still, this is not a political issue. Nobody, so every time we see Diwali and the, you know, whatever the crop season, et cetera, when the worst year, worst months, I see the Delhi Chief Minister, I know, one of the introductions of Chris that she has not given is that she's also, her husband is Ashish Khetan, very close to Arvind Kejriwalji, my good friend. So I see Kejriwalji tweeting that I want to meet Haryana Chief Minister. I see Haryana Chief Minister saying that I'm not in Chandigarh, you come 1 week later. I see Punjab Chief Minister saying that, you know, it's not our problem, et cetera, et cetera. Why can't everybody sit together? And that's what my bill proposed, that, you know, a board should be set up headed by the Prime Minister, which is mandated to meet every 6 months. It is not a problem which is going to go away in 1 or 2 years, or just around that time by tweeting or blaming each other. It's a problem that we need to solve. I mean, cities have solved that problem. Mexico City solved that problem. London solved that problem. We can solve that problem for our kids, for our next generation. But unfortunately, I don't agree with your first statement that people, you know, we think that it's an important issue. But the challenge in front of us, and so some of us in politics is also, to make some of these issues, which are critical to our young, for the next generation, the central political issues which get debated and which decide the kind of mandate and the direction in which we want to take our policy and polity. So that's not happening, and that's what we should be not satisfied with.
If you're throwing up your hands over this issue, imagine what this leaves the rest of the room with, because we have to come up with ideas. I think the doomsday scenario, that dystopian reality, is already here. If we're talking about life expectancy being shortened as a result of the quality of our air, and our children are being compromised, and no matter how many fixed deposits and trust funds you can put up for your kid, this is something you cannot give them, right? So where are those concrete ideas? I mean, because let's face it, apart from this room, there's a lot of people who have immediate everyday concerns, right? Roti, kapda, makan, that sort of thing. This is where parliamentarians and people who are policymakers step in and say, but you're throwing up your hands.
No, the broader point that I was making is I'm a little disappointed by the political discourse. And that's where I feel our country needs a vibrant, positive, progressive opposition. I'm quite disappointed, and I don't want to, you know, use this forum to do political blame game, etc., this and that, but, you know, the political discourse, I think that needs to change a little bit, and the standards need to be raised, and people will be for the deciding force, you know, people will be the guiding force which can make that happen. But, I mean, you see what's happening. I mean, you know, and to make a political point, you know, if you look at the results of Haryana, I'll come back to the political question now. BJP, sort of the results of Haryana shocked BJP. Or, abhi aap, पिछले एक महीने पहले से जब से इनकी बीजेपी की सरकार बनी हरियाणा में दोबारा से बनाई गई तब से बड़ी एक गजब की विडंबना हो रही है कि सरकार उनकी बन गई मगर वो हर जगह हरियाणा में हार के कारणों का मंथन कर रहे हैं तो मगर वो हुआ क्यों वो यही हुआ कि डिस्कनेक्ट, हम वो 370 की बात कर रहे थे, हम लोग अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट की बात कर रहे थे, हम लोग लैक ऑफ डेवलपमेंट की, लैक ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट की बात कर रहे थे, रियल इश्यूज की बात कर रहे थे, लोग समझ तो पा रहे थे, मगर पूरे मैं समझता हूँ कि जिस तरीके से इन मुद्दों पे चर्चा होनी चाहिए वो ना सिर्फ जो सत्ता पक्ष है, वो विपक्ष की भी उतनी भूमिका होती है, तो हम लोग सारे जिम्मेदार हैं। और सबसे ज़रूरी बात यह है कि हम जो लोग हैं, आई मीन पीपल, दे पीपल नीड टू बी यू नो द ड्राइविंग फोर्स टू ब्रिंग दैट चेंज सो दैट द पोलिटिकल डिस्कोर्स यू नो गेट्स इन द राइट डायरेक्शन। नहीं तो हम पूछेंगे अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट, जवाब मिलेगा आप योग करिए, हम पूछेंगे एयर क्वालिटी, आप करिए गीता पढ़िए। तो कहीं ना कहीं जो है हमें इन मुद्दों से आगे बढ़ना पड़ेगा, मैं समझता हूँ। और यही हरियाणा के अंदर जो बीजेपी को, ये हरियाणा के लोगों ने जो देश को एक मैसेज दिया वो यही मैसेज है कि अभी जो है आने वाले जो वर्ष हैं उन वर्षों में हमारे देश की राजनीति केवल कांग्रेस को मंथन नहीं करना पड़ेगा, हमें तो करना पड़ेगा मंथन, हमें अपना जो है, मगर साथ के साथ देश के अंदर जो राजनीतिक, जिस तरह से देश की राजनीतिक दिशा है उसमें भी वो जो मंथन है वो प्रभाव डालेगा, मुझे लगता है लोगों को भी मंथन करना पड़ेगा कि देश किस तरफ जाए।
Here's another thought. I've been thinking about, you know, the way the Congress has been sort of dealing with things and the way they've been conducting themselves. You have a situation where Rahul Gandhi was heading the Congress. You know, you have a few electoral losses. He hands over the reins and he says, okay, I don't think I'm worthy of this. And he had got the reins from his mother. And then it goes right back to Sonia Gandhi. And now you have a situation where people are, it seems rudderless to me. It seems like there's nobody that one can actually say, okay, the Congress is being led by this person. And everyone was really hoping that there would be a change of guard, because we find ourselves still being led by the old guard. What do you say to that? It seems like the Congress is in grip of dynastic politics, and all those criticisms are coming to bear.
See, first of all, you must understand that when Shri Rahul Gandhi became the Congress president, it was a matter of choice of the Congress, the lakhs of Congress workers across the state, across the country, state after state, unanimously decided that Rahul ji should lead the Congress party. There wasn't a single major opinion expressed otherwise. So it was a decision that the Congress workers made, which they felt is the best interest of the Congress party. Then he took the decision, took the responsibility after the loss of 2019 to resign. And there was a period of 3 months where there was a lot of thinking inside the Congress party, who would be the best person to steer the Congress party through this, through this critical period where, you know, the party is in crisis, the worst electoral performance that we have seen since our party's birth. And it was again unanimously decided by the Congress Working Committee, of which I am a member of, that in this critical hour, the best person who could lead the party through this critical time would be Srimati Sonia Gandhi. So at every stage, my point is, contrary to what what a perception that is sought to be created, no political leader has been imposed upon the Congress party from somewhere. It is at that moment what the decision of the Congress workers and the Congress Working Committee, who they decide. See, getting back to Sonia ji's passing the baton back to Sonia ji, like you said, there was a period of 3 months. It was not an automatic decision. And it wasn't an easy decision even for Srimati Sonia Gandhi to accept that when the Congress Working Committee urged her. But after spending those 3 months thinking about who would be the best person, it was unanimously felt by the Congress Working Committee members that she, with her experience and the kind of leadership that she has provided to the party in the past, she being a unifier, not only a unifying force for the party, but also the kind of credibility that she can bring to get the Congress party rallying around its vision, goal, ideology, would be the best person to lead the party. And that's when that decision was taken. So it's easy to make a blanket statement like that, Chris, but I think if you look at how we have taken that decision, the process that has been followed to take that decision, you would probably understand, you know, the why we took these decisions, and those decisions we have felt was in best interest of the Congress party.
There was supposed to be an election to decide the president of the Congress, and that is yet to happen, if I'm not mistaken.
There was an election which was held last year when Sri Rahulji was elected the Congress president.
Right.
When he decided to take the responsibility of the loss of the Lok Sabha election and resign, the Congress constitution mandates the Congress Working Committee to come up with an interim Congress president, to decide on a name for the interim Congress president. And then, once that name is decided, the Congress constitution provides that within the next 1 year, there should be fresh elections to elect a new Congress president. So we are in that period right now, technically answering your question now, since you really want to get into that. So now, within the next 1 year, we should hold fresh elections, and those elections will decide who the Congress president is going to be in the future.
How's the Huda relationship with the Gandhis?
See,
because from what I understand, you'll have set yourselves a target of 35 in this assembly election. And there was a sort of ambiguity about how this election would be run. And 1 month, literally 1 month before the decisive day, is when you'll jump into the fray in right earnest. And you'll come away with 31. Can you tell me that if you had maybe a month or two, you may not have hit that target?
See, I'll take the second question first. So, and that's a question, the flavor of the season, wherever I go, I get asked the question that had Hudaji been given the charge of elections 2 months or 3 months before, then for sure Congress would have formed the government, and he was just, you know, he just had 30 days, and in 30 days you came very close, but etc. But a decision still was taken. You must not forget, it was better late than never. So decision was taken. He was given that mantle. And our relationship with
the BJP had been working for, sorry to interrupt you, but the BJP had been working for 7 months, if I'm not mistaken, getting their act together for the Haryana elections.
But yet, BJP not only fell short, they fell horribly short. And they had to forge alliance with JJP, which sought votes in the name of throwing BJP out of power in Haryana. Like what is happening in Maharashtra now, they used all the tactics, all the agencies and whatnot to make sure that alliance is forged with JJP in Haryana. Look at what's happening in Maharashtra today. I mean, talking about government formation, the Anti-Corruption Bureau has dropped 11 cases against Ajit Pawar. 11 today, broad daylight. I mean, they took oath when the nation was sleeping, but in broad daylight, they dropped 11 corruption cases against Ajit Pawar today. And in Haryana, what happened with Dushyant Chautala, his father, and the cases is an open secret. So the government formation, so BJP, you're right, BJP got a lot more time and they perhaps would have been much more organized. But that just shows that in spite of all that, if we were almost tied with BJP, matter of 4,000 votes decided who the next government in Haryana is going to be, this shows the public sentiment, another thing which shows the public sentiment, media. So matter of 4,000 votes decided who the next, who's going to form the government in Haryana, as close as that. But what role the media played? I want to ask, that's an important question. For these 3 months, between Lok Sabha and Vidhan Sabha elections, every survey predicted that BJP is going to get between 70 to 83 seats out of 90. In fact, the last survey, which was broadcasted by ABP News, just 4 days before the polling, showed that BJP is getting 83 seats and the Congress is getting just 3 seats. I mean, do you think there are not going to be 4,000 people in Haryana somewhere who would change their mind seeing this survey that a BJP government aa rahi hai, 83 seat aa rahe hain, to ya to BJP ki dal do, ya agar they want to give a vote against the BJP, they're not happy with their performance on economic front, their performance on whatever front, they'll just say that, oh, but still they are getting, not only forming the government, they're getting 83 seats, better for me to sit at home and not go out and vote. So democracy is in peril. Let me say this as loud as clearly as I can. Democracy is in peril. It is not just in peril when you see anti-corruption cases, anti-corruption bureau dropping cases against Ajit Pawar and the Chautalas. Democracy is also in peril when you see the media showing that BJP is going to get 83 seats and Congress 3 seats, and the next day when the results come out, Congress gets, 31 seats, BJP gets 2 or 3 more seats and is able to steal the mandate. So this country needs strong opposition, vibrant opposition. This country needs an alternative vision, a progressive vision, which doesn't look to harness what divides us, but which looks to tap upon what unites us. There's lot many things that we have in common that we have not in common. And I think that vision, with the weakening of the Congress party, and the point that you made, weakening of the Congress party, this and that, that vision has gotten weaker. And that's not healthy for our country, and that's to answer your question. So that's the challenge that we have within the Congress party, that we will rise up to the occasion and bring that vision and that way forward to the people of the country when the next round of elections happen.
Jharkhand. That's the next round of elections.
I'm sure we are going to win Jharkhand, but the people need to be, people need to start speaking up now. So I'm sure the CBI and the ED and the Anti-Corruption Bureau, etc., everybody is doing rounds on all the people who are contesting elections in Jharkhand. And I guarantee you that whatever the results may happen, BJP is going to try to steal that mandate too. But still, I'm confident that now that the people have gotten a taste of what's happened in Haryana and Maharashtra, Jharkhand, I'm confident that we are going to turn the tables in Jharkhand.
I'm going to more or less, please go ahead, there's applause. I'm going to more or less wrap up. I mean, your father, Bhupinder Singh Hooda, and the kind of fight he fought is being compared to Sharad Pawar in their 70s. What a rousing display. What do you learn from him? Your grandfather was a freedom fighter. Your father, a four-time parliamentarian, right? What are those takeaways for you growing up in that kind of environment?
Now, there are a lot of questions combined into one. Because, My grandfather also, and the father, and my father also. That's a, it's a, see, and I can answer both those questions, and I can, because my grandfather again is one of my role models. He, like you said, you rightly said, he was a freedom fighter, and he fought for the freedom of our country fearlessly. By the time our country took birth in 1947, he was 32, and he had spent 8 years in prison, in the British prison. He was leading member of the Congress Party and fought for our country.
You know, I didn't know that. Like, I read extensively, but I didn't come across that.
Yeah. So he, so he was all. So he, 8 years he spent in prison, and one thing that I learned from that. Is that was, so he was 32, so all the 20s, his 20s, he did not know that India is ever going to be free. I mean, for all that matter, India could have, you know, 20 years later, India could have gotten its freedom. So people of that generation were ready to sacrifice their youth. Angrezo ki kal kotri mein apni jawaniyon ko shaheed karne ke liye tayyar the, apne adarsho ke liye, mulyo ke liye, is desh ki azadi ke liye. वो आदर्शवाद था, वो आदर्शवाद था, वो आदर्शवाद था. और अब वो जो आपकी स्पीकर बोल रही थी कि अब हम एनवायरनमेंट के लिए, अपनी अच्छी वायु के लिए, हम एक दिन भी सुबह प्रदर्शन करने के लिए जाते हैं तो सोचते हैं कि घर में जो है ये काम है, वो काम है, छोड़ के कैसे जाएंगे. तो वो जनरेशन थी. मैं तो, मुझे याद है अपने दादाजी से एक बार क्या उन्होंने जिंदगी जी होगी उन लोगों ने. मैंने एक बार उनसे, मैं देखता था छोटा था, मैं बच्चा था, तो अपने ही यूज टू शेव एवरी डे बट विदाउट लुकिंग एट द मिरर. आई आस्क्ड हिम दैट, दादाजी आप, पापा तो शीशा देख के शेव करते हैं और आप तो बिना शीशा देखे शेव करते हैं. कहते हैं अंग्रेजों की जेलों में शीशे नहीं होते थे. दैट्स व्हाट ही सेड. सो प्रोफाउंड थिंग. सो द काइंड ऑफ हार्डशिप्स फॉर आवर कंट्री. So he was, I mean, a role model for me, the equanimity with which he led his life. And now my father, like you rightly said, is a hero for me. And the kind of fight that he's fought. So like you said, he was a member of parliament 4 times. He's been a MLA, this is his 5th term. He's been 3 times leader of opposition in Haryana and 2 times chief minister of Haryana. But still, he gets up and he's ready to fight every single day. This election, after this Lok Sabha election, when everybody was said that let's lay the, just, I mean, it's, fight is over after the Lok Sabha election, it was so bad. I mean, BJP led out of 90, BJP had led in 79 assembly segments. And they, and media was predicting 83. And he would tell me every day. I was also very demoralized because I had lost my election narrowly by a couple of thousand votes. But he would tell me every day in the morning on the breakfast table that, Dipender, you just keep on fighting. I promise you, I will give them a bloody nose. So, I mean, the kind of fighting spirit and the kind of equanimity with which I've seen him take all these fights. I didn't see him getting overly joyous, happy, or elated when he became the chief minister. I didn't see him getting sad or demoralized when we lost the elections. So, I mean, there are so many lessons that for every person, their father, their grandfather are their heroes, and you know, they are role models, and you learn a lot of things from them. And similarly, my father is my hero, my grandfather is my role model, and you all try your best to, raise your bar and achieve what they have achieved in certain dimensions.
Thank you, Dipender, for taking my questions and hanging out with us this evening here on the Algebra stage. It's been a pleasure having you with us. Thank you.